Security team, 2 to 6. Thank you. Help, divert course. Diverting course, Captain. Engage.
bit of a secret. My last shot on the jump from the Excelsior class to the Ambassador class. And the same thing can be said on the jump from the Ambassador class to the Galaxy class. And this is actually where the Narendra class fits in quite nicely, otherwise known as the Prototype class, the Ambassador prototype, so to speak. There's an interesting discussion to be had over which is the better reflection of technological evolution. Certainly, the Ambassador class feels much more in line with what went before, whilst the Probot, Narendra class, feels much more in line with what will be born in the future in both the Galaxy and the Sovereign class, reaching far late 24th century design motifs than the Ambassador, which in many ways is just a jumbo constitution. Let me know your thoughts in the comments below. Bit of a sequel to my last short on the jump from the Excelsior class to the Ambassador class.
Does not have the resources with which to combat this catastrophe.
See,
2293, the government that enslaved me was continually raiding other governments. Federation, Seed's empire comes to the point of destruction. This largely due to their exploding. The Federation, the inhabitants of Spawn, reach out an olive branch and ultimately completely support the government economically. Now, to be fair, it's more complicated than I'm presenting it. Let's not underscore the fact that the Klingon Empire was still, in my opinion, a fascist government at the time. And even after the alliance, would not give up any of this territory or grant self-governance to the people that had been enslaved by the Klingons. Hell, this ally of the Federation would not allow women to serve the top echelons of the body politic. They couldn't be on the council without a phenomenal exception. The rot within the Empire would not even be burnt out, since we'd see how easy it is for the Klingons to revert back to who they were when they disagree with the United Federation of Planets. And you know, in the next generation, what Romulus had said was ultimately true. Starfleet had no leash on the Klingons. That was about it. Hadn't really changed them. Not yet, anyway. Speaking of governments that could never be leashed, that leads us to the Cardassian Empire.
I had attempted to board that ship. I'm quite certain that you and I would not be having this pleasant conversation. The ship's on both sides, now we're parking for war.
They had a government set up to look like it had some semblance of democracy or free thought, but this government was ultimately a military dictatorship that, due to the lack of resources, was extremely expansionistic. It pushed out on all sides, coming up against the borders of the Federation, causing the Cardassian wars. How did the Federation and Starfleet deal with such a threat that was known to harm its own people? They granted a deal that ceded planets and territories, agreeing an area where the Federation citizens were under Cardassian. And note, there was one Viking colony that came under their own rights, but that wasn't all of the Viking colonies. Let's not underscore this. The Federation made a deal that ceded planets. And after giving up all this territory, the Federation not only continued to keep this agreement, but did nothing as Federation citizens under Cardassian were subjugated, tortured, and sometimes even killed. The Federation continued to have open relations and trade agreements with the Cardassians, even though they knew that the military was actively helping dissidents to attack its own citizens. They said paradise would put people in danger.
See, it is their sacred duty to bring order to the galaxy. Their order. You think they'll sit idly by while you keep your chaotic empire right next to their perfect order? No.
Speaking of the Cardassians, we can't discuss them without thinking of the Dominion. The Dominion is a military government. It's all of its power by the changelings. This means great slave races to do their bidding. Ordo, the Templars, and the Genitar, soldiers. They require all of the species that are conquered and consumed by them to gear their efforts towards the body politic and green weapons and technology to right. The Federation would not only engage in diplomatic overtures with this hostile government attempt to come to peace accords and agreements. There would be joint military operations against rebel elements within the Dominion. Hell, the Federation would do anything to help to wipe out the Maquis. You remember those Federation seasons I was talking about a little bit about less than 30 seconds ago? Yeah, they killed all of them. And the Federation and Starfleet did nothing. They only decided to engage in military intervention after
Excellent. Navig will be in to get some things straightened out.
Maybe. Those gold panels have an official ship business. But if they're so important, why don't they need an executive? Now just a minute. I'm in a very serious and potentially dangerous situation. I'm sure whatever it is in there. But my situation is far more critical. And in situation, before how much time has passed, but comes in a very heavy way. It is simply that I am going to protect the manager position, plus the executive. No matter. But a military career has never been considered to be a worthy one. I must contact my lawyer.
Thank you.
My second tour in Iraq as an F-16 pilot, I witnessed a family as their fallen soldier returned home. I felt a calling to help. Budweiser has believed in Folds of Honor for 13 years. Today, we honor our veterans with 44,000 scholarships and memories to their families. That's enough to fill this stadium. Service never stops, and neither will we. There are always a ton of cool little facts that don't really fit anywhere in a video of their own that I still think are very interesting and worth talking about. So here's a list of over 50 small pieces of trivia from Aftermath Empire's End. Obviously, spoilers are ahead. Emperor Palpatine referred to the Battle of Endor as a shatter point. In Legends, this was an event or a point in time that could have serious implications on galactic history. Palpatine was prepared for at least the possibility of his death at the Battle of Endor, which we can see proof of in the Shattered Empire comic. The planet Taris is heavily featured in an early chapter, and at least part of it is described as a wasteland. This could be a reference to the devastation it experienced in the now Legends game, Knights of the Old Republic. Chewbacca's son, Lumpa Waru, is back from Legends, but instead of Lumpy, his nickname is now Waru. Maybe it used to be Lumpy, but when he became a teenager, he demanded that his parents call him something else. We're introduced to Nima the Hutt on Jakku. She's different from other Hutts we've seen, described as more snake than slug-like. Durga the Hutt is also mentioned along with his yacht, so they're back from Legends as well. Let's hope the Darksaber superweapon stays gone. Jar Jar Binks was exiled and ostracized again after the Clone Wars because he was thought to have colluded with the Empire. I actually sympathized with Jar Jar, and now I'm confused. We've known since the first Aftermath book that Mon Mothma demilitarized the New Republic, but the goal was for planets to maintain their own militaries that could form a coalition should the need arise. She wanted to decentralize military and power, not get rid of it entirely. A prototype Black T-70 X-Wing exists at this point. Imbo is still alive. His Anuba, Marok, has unfortunately passed away. Dengar makes multiple appearances after joining a new bounty hunting team. Boba Fett's armor is still in possession of a sheriff on Tatooine. There's no sign of Fett himself, but I have to say the sheriff is pretty badass. B-1 battle droids have autonomic repair mode, so given enough time and functionality, they can repair themselves. Gallius Rax has more advanced models of the red-robed sentinel droid seen in Shattered Empire. The Church of the Force took it upon themselves to return kyber crystals to their rightful planets, often at great risk. The Church of the Force believed that the Jedi, in fact, did not control the Force, but rather they were conduits for it. That sounds more like Churrit to me, but hey, they can believe whatever they want. A reading from the Journal of the Wills includes the phrase, from a certain point of view, so I guess Obi-Wan was literally quoting scripture to Luke to get out of lying to him. Another church saying is, all hail the light, the dark, and the gray, which again alludes to Star Wars storytelling moving towards a more neutral use of the Force. When the New Republic Senate left Chandrilla, it moved to the planet Nacadia. Nacadia is very different from Coruscant, Chandrilla, or Hosnian Prime. It's an agricultural planet. It seems to be a concerted effort to not show preference to only the highly populated or more snooty planets of the galaxy. Mos Amita was kept locked up in the Imperial Palace after the Battle of Endor. As a child, General Hux was emotionally and physically abused by his father. Hutts are strong enough to flip Lambda-class shuttles, or at least Nima is. Imperial loyalty officers were taught torture methods by being tortured and broken themselves. The acolytes of the Beyond all received dreams and visions of ancient Sith. We don't currently know why or how. They've destroyed multiple red lightsabers, hoping to return them to their former masters. Yup Tashu is revealed as one of their leaders, Perhaps other surviving members of Palpatine's advisors hold similar roles. The young members of the Acolytes are further corrupted by Sith artifacts. The Acolytes of the Beyond launch a coordinated simultaneous attack on multiple planets throughout the galaxy. U-Wings are still seen in service, but I think they would either have to be rare or new models based on tweets by Pablo Hidalgo claiming that most of them were destroyed during the Battle of Scarif. Leia feels the light side of the Force in her unborn son, and she remembers a warning from Luke. He told her the brighter the light, the darker the shadow. Leia also notices Han's restlessness, which is further evidenced in the book Bloodline. The first generation of the kidnapped child soldiers we see in The Force Awakens are truly terrifying. They're like an army of Aryas from Game of Thrones, just tiny little children murderers. Phantom Squadron makes another appearance. It's possible the squadron could be named after Wedge's time in service with the crew of the Ghost in Star Wars Rebels. Mr. Bones gets a line directly lifted from HK-47. 2 years ago at Dragon Con, I think I remember Chuck Wendig saying he wanted Mr. Bones to be HK-47, but Lucasfilm wouldn't allow it. But take that with a grain of salt, I'm going off a two-year-old memory right now. TIE Strikers also appear at the Battle of Jakku, so the fighters weren't relegated only to Scarif. The Tirfan Yellow Aces are specifically mentioned engaging in AT-AT. This could be the very important and absolutely necessary origin story of Rey's adorable helmet. The cockpit of the Lambda-class shuttle doubles as an escape pod. That was true in Star Wars Legends, but now that's canon too. Lando and Lobot finish retaking Cloud City from the Empire. Lando decides to give Ben Solo a fancy gun and a fancy ship as a present. The Mandalorian Wars are mentioned again, this time as an example of how a smaller fleet was victorious against a larger one. In this case, the Mandalorians defeated the Old Republic's fleet. Another example given is the Ghostfinder fleet against the Sith Armada. I have no idea what the Ghostfinder fleet is, but I desperately want to find out. For their help during the Battle of Jakku, Dengar and Imbo receive full pardons from the New Republic. The Galactic Civil War is ended when Mos Amita escapes his imprisonment and signs the Galactic Concordance. An assassination attempt on Mon Mothma's life unfortunately kills one of her aides.